Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unabashed Women, the fascinating biographies of bad girls, seductresses, rebels, and one-of-a-kind women. By Marlene Wagman-Geller. Narrated by Hilary Huber. Well-behaved women seldom make history. Laurel Ulrich, 1976. I decided long ago never to walk in anyone's shadow. Linda Creed and Michael Masser, 1977. Introduction. Anyone's shadow. What are little girls made of? Sugar and spice and all things nice. That's what little girls are made of. When Mother Goose penned her rhyme, little did she realize the heavy load she had placed on female shoulders. To be nice is daunting. And what of those girls who shirk the role of Ms. Goody Two-Shoes? In every age, in every clime, there are those whose DNA does not contain the Pollyanna gene. Ever since Eve, the original bad girl, went against God's directive against eating from the tree of good and evil, wayward women have had a bad rap. The wages of sin was an angel with a flaming sword who ensured eternal banishment from paradise. Eve's punishment, as well as that of all her female descendants, was to give birth in great pain. As penance for his participation in original sin, her partner and his male descendants had to work by the sweat of their brow. No more free rides, thanks to the lady fashioned from Adam's rib. From this biblical couple, the male-female power structure was born. Throughout the first millennium, the standard of womanhood was to exercise modesty, especially in the sexual arena. The Old Testament admonishes, "Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies." Revered role models remain Madonna, not the material girl, and Mother Teresa, hard shoes to fill. In the medieval era, when the knights rode off on crusades to ensure their wives didn't play while their hubbies were away, they devised the chastity belt. After all, trust can only go so far. While brides wear white to signify virginity, a prize surrendered on the wedding night, males are allowed free rein to their libido due to the mindset of boys will be boys. The male adage for sexual conquest, a notch on the crotch, is a much vaunted trophy. A woman equally liberal with her body is viewed as a slut. Rebel girls viewed the legs crossed mindset as another way for the patriarchy to clip their wings. Language is symptomatic of societal mores, and English has a plethora of words to describe women who do not walk the prescribed gauntlet. The most derogatory put-downs for those ladies who do not subscribe to the time-honored double standard for sexual transgressions: whore, cougar, frigid, feel free to add your own, all of which have no male equivalent. And no matter how much one peruses Webster's, there is no male counterpart for wallflower or shrinking violet. Other searing adjectives to describe pushy broads: sassy, shrill, spinster, hag, ditzy, bitch, hormonal. And we have a newer term to describe a bride who places unreasonable demands on her wedding party: bridezilla. No one seems to feel the need to use the male equivalent of groomzilla. Fortunately, or unfortunately, depending on perspective, there have always been badass broads. In Aristophanes' 411 BC play Lysistrata, the titular heroine arranged for wives to withhold sex until their soldier husbands ended the Peloponnesian War. As a further measure, the ladies took over the Acropolis, which halted access to the money funding the feud between Athens and Sparta. Another feisty fictional femme was the lady whose name manifested her fiery spirit, Scarlett O'Hara, from Margaret Mitchell's Gone with the Wind. Unlike most women in the antebellum South, Scarlett was brash, bratty, and ballsy. She is far more memorable than her arch-rival Melanie Hamilton Wilkes, the embodiment of virtue, the quintessential good girl. Another woman who gave no fucks was Lisbeth Salander, the tattooed, chain-smoking anti-heroine who favored courtier goth. Non-shrinking violets go through life with unpraised middle finger, with an ever-ready retort. Much to the chagrin of those who looked askance at gender equality, there were always women who did not abide by the premise that, when playing a game, everyone accepts the same rules. And for their daring to listen to a different drummer, for their audacity of treading the road less traveled, condemnation was swift. Society put them in pillories of social ostracism, marking them with figurative scarlet letters. Liberal ladies often use ink as a means to fight against a hostile status quo that does its utmost to keep different femmes in line. Dorothy Parker, the Jewish girl from Jersey, had no tolerance for the constraints of a Victorian mindset. As a prolific drinker in the era of Prohibition, she smoked and slept with whomever caught her fancy. In the 1920s, a decade when the Ku Klux Klan had its largest membership, she wrote the short story, Arrangement in Black and White, to skewer racism. Her take me or leave me philosophy, which expression summed up her romantic history, can be explained in Parker's words, but I shall stay the way I am because I do not give a damn. Unabashed Women pays homage to the anti-Martha Stewarts, those who do not define themselves by their prowess in the kitchen or the bedroom, those who pride themselves from the shadows. Although they paid a price for their ballsy behavior, they, in the words of Mr. Sinatra, had the satisfaction of being able to say, I did it my way. The Mother Goose counterpart for little boys is what are little boys made of? Snips and snails and puppy dog tails. That's what little boys are made of. The ladies who made leaps into the flames are an amalgam of the sugar and the spice. The most memorable of the Shakespearean heroes were great men with fatal flaws that made them relatable, human. The ladies profiled in Unabashed Women serve as their female counterparts. Their prickly personalities did not earn them the title Miss Congeniality, though it freed them of cookie-cutter corsets. They left their historic imprints because they dared to be different and difficult. In the final analysis, badness is in the eye of the beholder. The list of feisty females is legion, including the 19th century British author Charlotte Bronte. Jane Eyre, although madly in love with Mr. Rochester, spurns his proposal to live with him as his mistress in his estate, Thornfield Hall. The protagonist's response, an eyebrow raiser in its time, I am no bird, and no net ensnares me. I am a free human being with an independent will, which I will now exert to leave you. Similar to Ms. Eyre, the Unabashed Women were no birds. Although the ladies who populate this book come from different eras and far-flung locales, a common thread binds them, the refusal to let their light be dimmed by another. Martha Gellhorn, the journalist wife of Ernest Hemingway, wrote, Why should I be a footnote to someone else's life? Françoise Gillot, the painter and common-law wife of Pablo Picasso, declared, I'm not here just because I've spent time with Picasso. In fairy tales, bliss arrives in the guise of a prince. In literature, Heathcliff's passion extends beyond the grave. In film, Ricky Blaine's devotion to Ilsa is the litmus test of adoration. However, songwriters Michael Masser and Linda Creed argue that the greatest commitment has to be to oneself, a philosophy shared by those who forge their own paths. Their lyrics, immortalized by Whitney Houston, state, I decided long ago never to walk in anyone's shadow. Chapter 1. Quand même, 1844. Slow down? Rest? With all eternity before me? Sarah Bernhardt. Used a letter holder named Sophie made from a human skull? Check. Accessorized with a stuffed bat? Check. Slept in a coffin? Check. The woman who could answer in the affirmative to these questions was also the possessor of the honorific divine. The flamboyant 19th century actress's name is employed by mothers to criticize their melodramatic daughters. Who do you think you are? Sarah Bernhardt? However, no matter how histrionic, no matter how eccentric, no one could emulate the famed star in eccentricity, in talent, in hubris. Sarah Bernhardt's onstage and offstage lives rivaled one another in showmanship. She was the illegitimate daughter of Yule Bernhardt, a Jewish woman from Amsterdam who became a sought-after courtesan when she arrived in Paris, and a father who was most likely an officer from Le Havre. Sarah spent her early years with a foster family in Brittany and later attended a convent near Versailles. A drama queen when thwarted, on one occasion she threw herself in front of a carriage, on another, out a window. Yule did not involve herself in Sarah's life, other than to make her contribute to the family's income by working as a teenage courtesan. The Duc de Morny, the half-brother of Napoleon III, one of Yule's lovers, perceiving Sarah would be as much a drama queen on stage as off, arranged for the 15-year-old to attend the prestigious Paris Conservatory for Dramatic Arts. 2 years later, she transferred to the Comédie Française. After watching her first production, she pronounced, "The curtain of my life has risen." She failed to attract notice, partially because she was considered unfashionably thin. A wit remarked that Sarah was so skinny that when she got into a bath, the water level went down. As Alexandre Dumas-Fils, novelist and Sarah's friend, observed, "You know she's such a liar that she may even be fat." Critics panned her performances, and further salt entered the wound when Yule told her, "See? The whole world calls you stupid, and the whole world knows that you're my child." The performance that captured the public's interest took place in 1893 at an event that played out behind the theater's curtain. Régine, Sarah's younger sister, was with her at an annual ceremony to honor Molière and accidentally stepped on the train of veteran actress Madame Nathalie. Angered, the older woman shoved Régine against a pillar. Sarah's knee-jerk reaction was to scream, "You miserable bitch!" and slap Nathalie on both cheeks. Sarah refused to apologize, and in the first publicity coup of her career, she tore up her contract. The incident made her the talk and toast of Paris. Sarah depended on wealthy lovers for support until she joined the Théâtre de l'Odéon, run by a father and son. She slept with them both. Her performances made her a star in the theatrical firmament. When she played the Queen of Spain in Victor Hugo's play, Ruy Blas, the aged writer knelt down, kissed her hand, and uttered, "Merci, merci." The tribute was genuine, not merely the result of their earlier affair, in the course of which he had gifted her a human skull. She took a brief hiatus in 1864 for the birth of her son Maurice, whose father may have been a passing Belgian dalliance with Prince de Ligne. Although a consummate narcissist, Sarah still possessed a soul. During the 1870 siege of Paris, she transformed the Odéon into a field hospital, filling the stage, dressing rooms, and auditorium with cots for the injured and the dying. She persuaded her well-heeled stockholders, the name she gave to her lovers who supported her lifestyle, to supply medicine and food, and convinced one to donate his overcoat. She also thumbed her nose when it came to religion. Sarah had been raised as a Catholic, and as a child, she had entertained an inspiration to be a nun. Indeed, one of her prized possessions was a rosary, a gift from Pope Leo XIII. Nevertheless, in an age of virulent anti-Semitism, she adhered to her Jewish roots. Caricatures circulated of her with a Star of David and bags of money, denoting her as a money-grubbing Jew. The only truly embittered disagreement she had with her beloved son was over the Dreyfus affair, when she defended the Jewish officer charged with treason. Due to her surging popularity, the Comédie Française arranged her return, and she transformed into its shining star. The newspaper Le Figaro declared that everyone was coming to Paris to gaze upon its two main attractions, the newly erected Eiffel Tower and Sarah Bernhardt. Sigmund Freud wrote of her performance, "My head is reeling," and he hung her photo in his office. D.H. Lawrence compared her to a gazelle with a beautiful panther's fascination and fury. Mark Twain observed, "There are five kinds of actresses: bad actresses, fair actresses, good actresses, great actresses, and then there is Sarah Bernhardt." The Divine, her honorific leading lady, also served as muse. Oscar Wilde wrote Salome for her. Marcel Proust portrayed her in his novel, In Search of Lost Time. Aubrey Beardsley drew her portrait as Salome, holding John the Baptist's severed head. One naysayer was the Irish playwright George Bernard Shaw, who later admitted his acrimony was because she had reminded him of his Aunt Georgina. From 1880 onwards, Sarah toured Europe and America, and she took along her menagerie of pets: dogs, a snake, and an alligator called Ali Gaga, who passed away after consuming too much champagne. Adoring fans lavished tributes. Australians danced to the Bernhard Waltz. Argentina presented Sarah with 13,000 acres of land. In London, Oscar Wilde laid lilies at her feet. In America, reporters bombarded the famed thespian. What was her waist size? Did she feed live birds to her lion cub? In New York, Sarah made her way to a theater through a crowd of worshippers who demanded she sign their shirt cuffs. At one point, to avoid the throng, her younger sister, Jean, camouflaged in Sarah's outlandish clothes, hoodwinked the public so the prima donna could make her getaway. She took the opportunity to visit Thomas Edison, likewise smitten, who gave her a tour of his laboratory. In return, he persuaded her to make a recording on his new invention, the phonograph. However, not everyone was in Camp Bernhardt. Fundamentalist preachers pronounced her sinful. Ever resourceful, when a Texas theater owner refused to rent his place for her performance, she set up her own tent in a field. Ladies in the audience returned home with the hems of their dresses frayed by the corn stalks. The woman who had grown up in a foster home, with money from her roles as an actress and a courtesan, purchased her own home, located in the Parc Monceau area of Paris, as over-decorated as her stage sets. She shared the space with Maurice, her menagerie of pets, and a constant stream of visitors. Guests who came through her door were the stuff of legend: Theodore Roosevelt, Oscar Wilde, Louis Pasteur, Victor Hugo, Emile Zola. The hostess also served as a muse. Alexander Dumas-Fils declared after a visit, "But when I get home, how I can write, how I can write." The most utilized piece of furniture in her home was the Bernhardt bed. Lovers were legion. Some of the famous were Victor Hugo, Charles Haas, Proust's model for his character Swan, Albert Edward, a.k.a. the Prince of Wales, and Gustave Doré. An equal opportunity lover, Sarah also slept with a variety of female paramours. Along with her own property, Sarah, who always desired to be at the helm of her ship, commandeered her own playhouse that she unsurprisingly christened the Théâtre Sarah Bernhardt. In a signature exit at the close of a Bernhardt production, in a male role such as Hamlet, she would expertly expire on stage. A critic was so inspired, he wrote, "Dying as angels would die, were they allowed to." In the same show, the audience rose to its feet. Their enthusiasm was not diminished by the fact that the star was 56 and had played the role of a 20-year-old. Despite looking after her exotic animals, grueling schedule, and erotic liaisons, Sarah also took the conventional step of marriage. She fell for a dissolute Greek shipping heir, Aristides Damalis, 12 years her junior, who she described as pleased with himself as Narcissus. They married in England in 1882, between her engagements in Naples and Nice. He worked as a representative of a Greek delegation stationed in Paris, and due to diplomatic indiscretion, his country reassigned him to a post in St. Petersburg. Acting the part of the devoted wife, Sarah changed her tour engagements and followed him to Russia. Alas, Aristides slipped back into his morphine habit and one day abruptly deserted to join the French Foreign Legion. When he died from his drug addiction at age 42, Sarah referred to herself as the widow Demolis. Irish writer Bram Stoker said he had partly based his character Dracula on Sarah's husband. Alongside Van Gogh's ear, Bernhardt's leg is the most famous appendage in history. She had suffered an injury when she leapt from a parapet while performing La Tosca that resulted in years of chronic pain. According to legend, while enduring an amputation under anesthetic, she had drifted into unconsciousness while singing La Marseillaise. P.T. Barnum offered her $10,000 for the severed limb to put on display. She refused. "If it's my right leg you want, see the doctors. If it's the left leg, see my manager in New York." 8 months later, at age 71, she starred in La Dame aux Camélias, the play that Verdi later adapted as La Traviata, where she moved about the stage in a wheelchair that she preferred to a wooden leg. Shortly afterwards, Sarah set off for her ninth and last American tour to convince the United States to enter World War I. Undaunted, she left for the front to entertain the troops, where she described herself as hopping about like a guinea hen. The immortal thespian specialty was dying from daggers, betrayal, heartbreak. When the actress herself passed away in her son's arms in 1923, thousands of Parisians gathered at the Théâtre Sarah Bernhardt to pay homage. During World War II, the Germans deconsecrated the playhouse because of Sarah's Jewish roots, and thus it became the Théâtre de la Ville. Her funeral was the largest since that of her admirer, Victor Hugo. Currently, Sarah's leg resides at Bordeaux University Medical School. Her tomb lies in Père Lachaise Cemetery. Of all the reams of dialogue that Sarah spoke, perhaps her remarkable life is best encapsulated by words she uttered at age 9, when she leapt across a ditch that none of her friends would attempt. The French translation is, "In spite of everything," or "after all," the verbal equivalent of a shrug, quand même. Chapter 2, Girdled the Globe, 1864. I have never written a word that did not come from my heart. I never shall. Elizabeth Cochrane, Nellie Bly. Some women can fit into one of the following categories: world traveler, 14 siblings, wife of a millionaire, spent time in a madhouse, owned a pet monkey. In all likelihood, only the 19th century version of Brenda Starr dipped her toes in all of these waters. The lady who beat a literary character at his own game was Elizabeth Jane, nicknamed Pinky by her mother, Mary Jane. Her father, Judge Michael Cochrane, who had risen from mill worker to mill owner, had founded her hometown, Cochrane Mills, Pennsylvania. The judge had brought to his second family 10 children from his first marriage, and his second wife gave birth to 5 more. Tragedy struck when Michael passed away when Elizabeth was 6 and Mary Jane remarried, then divorced an abusive alcoholic. With the aspiration of becoming a teacher, Elizabeth enrolled in the state normal school. Unable to afford the tuition, Elizabeth dropped out and helped her mother run a Pittsburgh boarding house. In 1885, Elizabeth read a column in the Pittsburgh Dispatch by Erasmus Wilson that bore the title, "What Are Women Good For?" According to the Post, the answer was, "Not much, other than to be a helpmeet to a man." Erasmus described working women as a monstrosity. Infuriated, Elizabeth wrote a scathing rebuttal and signed her letter, "Poor Little Orphan Girl." The newspaper's editor, George A. Madden, taken with the writer's moxie, ran an ad asking the little orphan girl to reveal her identity. When Elizabeth came forward, he asked her to write a column that she entitled "The Girl Puzzle," that called for reform in the divorce laws that were weighted against wives. Madden offered her a full-time position at $5 a week. Casting about for a nom de plume, she had previously added an E to Cochrane, Madden turned for inspiration to Pittsburgh-born Stephen Foster, who had penned My Old Kentucky Home, the anthem of the Kentucky Derby. The editor landed on another Foster song, Nellie Bly, though her editor misspelled it as Nellie with an IE, thus establishing her byline. Elizabeth began her journalistic career by going undercover in sweatshops, reporting on the wretched conditions of their female workers. Infuriated factory owners threatened to withdraw their advertisements. Consequently, the newspaper only allowed Elizabeth to write articles that fell into the category later known as the Pink Ghetto, focusing on topics such as flower shows and fashion. Miserable, she convinced her bosses to make her a foreign correspondent, and she left for Mexico. For several months, she traveled throughout the country, reporting on corruption and poverty. Her acerbic articles infuriated the government, and fearing arrest, she returned to the States. Her experiences were chronicled in a book, 6 Months in Mexico. Once again obliged to write on entertaining and childcare, Elizabeth quit in protest. Her last act before her departure was to leave a note on Erasmus's desk. I'm off to New York. Look out for me. Bly. In New York, Elizabeth arranged a meeting with Joseph Pulitzer, owner of the New York World. Pulitzer agreed to employ her if she infiltrated the Women's Lunatic Asylum, located on Blackwell's Island, currently Roosevelt Island. The famed newspaper tycoon did not provide any plan on how to gain entry or how to leave once committed. In 1887, the activist became an actress in order to appear a madwoman. Cochrane checked into a boarding house in the working-class Bowery District under the name Nellie Brown. She pretended she was from Cuba, wailed that she was searching for missing trunks, screamed, an act aided by rats scurrying across her pillow, and demanded a pistol. Her guise of insanity was so convincing that her roommate refused to sleep in the same room with her for all the money of the Vanderbilts. Doctors declared her positively demented. A few days later, Elizabeth was aboard a ferry, where she observed two coarse, massive female attendants who expectorated tobacco juice about on the floor in a manner more skillful than charming. In Blackwell's Island, Elizabeth joined 1,600 other unfortunates and experienced inhumane treatments, including filthy garments, rancid food, and sadistic caregivers. Complaints resulted in beatings with a broom. Elizabeth asked, "What, accepting torture, would produce insanity quicker than this treatment?" Baths consisted of 3 buckets of freezing water poured over her head that gave the sensation of drowning. When she was dripping wet, nurse ratchets forced her into a garment that bore the words, "Lunatic Asylum, B.I.H. 6, for Blackwell's Island, Hall 6. When Elizabeth asked for a suitable nightgown, an attendant sneered, "We have no such things here. You are in a public institution. Don't expect anything or any kindness here, for you won't get it." The 23-year-old reporter lived among those who were psychotic and suicidal. Others were there because their husbands wanted them out of the way. One inmate's heavily accented German was mistaken for gibberish, which led to a diagnosis of madness. Even when Elizabeth dropped her act and appeared coherent, no attention was paid. Starving and exhausted, Elizabeth was overjoyed when lawyers from the New York World secured her release. Newspapers published Cochrane's expose as 10 Days in a Madhouse. In it, she likened the asylum to a human rat trap under the headline, "Inside the Madhouse." The article recounted how hospital administrators injected their patients with so much morphine that they were rendered comatose. The account shocked the public to such a degree that a month later, the city added $1 million to the institution's budget and arranged for the facility's facelift. Bly became a journalistic Robin Hood, exposing the rotten core of the Big Apple. Whenever there was an injustice against women, children, or the poor, Nellie Bly was there. To investigate how females fared in New York City jails, she posed as a thief in order to experience incarceration. Her attempt failed when the police recognized her and gave her preferential treatment. On one occasion, she wrote about the black market. "I bought a baby last week to learn how baby slaves are bought and sold in this city of New York. Think of it, an immortal soul bartered for $10. Future assignments involved meeting the female power players of the day, such as Susan B. Anthony, whom Bly called the champion of her sex. In articles about Emma Goldman, she portrayed the activist as a person rather than an anarchist. Ages ahead of her time, in a column, she posed the marital question, "Should women propose?" A 19th-century Renaissance woman, in her free time, Elizabeth took up elephant training and ballet. After a stint in a madhouse, what could a famous reporter do next? Elizabeth found her idea in the Jules Verne novel Around the World in 80 Days. She approached Pulitzer with a proposal that she could beat the record of protagonist Phileas Fogg. Although impressed by the concept, Pulitzer told her that her gender would make the trip impossible. Cochrane's response was, "Very well, start the man and I'll start the same day for some other newspaper and beat him." The New York World conceded. Cochrane added that she would make the trip without a chaperone and with only one small satchel. Dressed in her trademark black and white plaid Ulster coat and hat that resembled Sherlock Holmes's deerstalker cap, Elizabeth boarded the steamship Augusta Victoria, bound for England. In dispatches to the New York World, Elizabeth chronicled her experiences, such as the casino in Egypt where she lost money at roulette, the snake charmer in Ceylon, and the instruments of torture in China. Another stop was a visit to Verne and his wife Honorine at their home in Amiens, France. Committed to traveling light, her only souvenir was a monkey she christened McGinty, purchased for $3 in Singapore. The New York World experienced a spike in sales covering her voyage. Riding the wave of the journalist's surging popularity, companies issued trading cards and games with her image. A hotel, a train, and a racehorse bore her name. In a voyage that entailed donkeys, rickshaws, and horses, after 72 days, 6 hours, and 11 minutes, Elizabeth returned, an international celebrity. Thousands of fans greeted her as she stepped off the train. 10 celebratory gunshots boomed from Battery Park. Boats in New York Harbor sounded their horns. A mountain of congratulatory telegrams awaited, including one from Verne. Cochrane reveled in her reputation that, as an admirer put it, established the American woman as pushing, determined, and independent. The young woman who embodied Scarlett O'Hara's waist as well as her gumption became America's most well-known woman. A book chronicled her adventures. Nellie Bly's book, Around the World in 72 Days, 1890. Because of her journalistic coup, Elizabeth expected a bonus and editorial recognition, but Pulitzer scarcely acknowledged her feat. Angered at the lack of appreciation, Cochrane quit and embarked on a lecture tour, which earned her $9,500, $250,000 in contemporary currency. In 1890, upon the death of her brother Charles, Elizabeth took her widowed sister-in-law and her two children under her wing. At age 30, Elizabeth married Robert Livingston Seaman, a millionaire 40 years her senior. Fans and friends joked that she was only trying wedlock for the story. However, she abandoned reporting to work with her husband in his steel container business, the Ironclad Manufacturing Company, which employed a workforce of 1,500. Upon his death, she took over the factory and instituted numerous reforms, including health and recreation benefits, showing more empathy than business acumen. The business floundered, forcing Elizabeth into bankruptcy. Once again experiencing the financial straits of her childhood, she returned to journalism with The World, where her columns were dedicated to unearthing corruption. In 1913, Cochrane covered the woman suffrage procession and published the report with the headline, "Suffragettes Are Men's Superiors." The draw of World War I proved a powerful magnet, and she boarded the RMS Oceanic for a 3-week stint in Vienna. She became the first woman reporting on the Eastern Front. The New York Evening Journal published Nellie Bly on the firing line, a column that carried her reports of the carnage. In the thick of the fighting, she fell under suspicion and ended up under arrest as a British spy. In her final years as a reporter for the New York Journal, Elizabeth took up the cause of abandoned, abused, and missing children and became a fairy godmother to an orphaned girl. Elizabeth Cochrane, immortalized as Nellie Bly, passed away from pneumonia, and her interment took place in the Bronx. One would hope that her last thoughts, rather than returning to the 10 days in the madhouse, instead relived her time of glory when she had, as the New York World had reported, girdled the globe. Chapter 3. Never the Twain Shall Meet, 1876. Taxation without representation is a tyranny. Princess Sophia Duleep Singh. When Jack let go of Rose's hand and disappeared into the icy depths of the Atlantic Ocean, Titanic fans let out a collective gasp. Those of a less romantic bent were left wondering why the elderly Rose consigned the diamond known as Le Cœur de la Mer, the heart of the ocean, to a watery grave. The non-celluloid counterpart to the fabulous blue gem reveals another tragic tale. Princess Sophia Alexandrovna Duleep Singh was the granddaughter of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, the legendary one-eyed lion of the Punjab, who ruled the Sikh empire that extended from the Khyber Pass in the west to Kashmir in the north to Tibet in the east. He rode through his empire with the storied Koh-i-Noor diamond strapped to his sleeve. A century later, the gem became the prized possession of Ranjit Singh. After his passing, at which time several of his wives burned themselves on his funeral pyre, the next Maharaja was his son, Duleep Singh. The British seized control and forced the 11-year-old to relinquish his kingdom to the crown. 4 years later, Duleep left for exile in England, where he converted from Sikhism to Christianity. Queen Victoria said of her subject, "I always feel so much for these poor deposed Indian princes." Her pity did not extend to returning his lands or the Koh-i-Noor. The king, without a kingdom, married Bamba Muller, who had been born in Cairo, the illegitimate daughter of a German merchant and an Abyssinian slave who placed their child in a missionary ward. In compensation for the confiscation of his birthright, Queen Victoria provided a £2.5 million annual stipend in contemporary currency. The money led to Elvedon Hall, a Suffolk estate transformed into a Mughal palace. Sophia was the fifth of his 6 surviving children, and the Singhs lived in great luxury. Gardens held ostriches, leopards, and Indian hawks. Queen Victoria became Sophia's godmother and gifted the child a sumptuously dressed doll known as Little Sophie. The Prince of Wales paid regular visits. A presentation for debutantes at Buckingham Palace ensured Sophia's social standing. The idols of the Punjab princess came with an expiration date. Her parents' marriage ended due to her father's promiscuity, gambling, and opulent lifestyle. Unable to pay his exorbitant debts, Duleep, who referred to Queen Victoria as Mrs. Fagin after the criminal in Oliver Twist, dedicated himself to wresting back his stolen kingdom. When the British government foiled his attempt to return to India, Duleep ran off with Ada, a hotel chambermaid, leaving his family in dire financial circumstances. Upon hearing of his wife's death, he sent a telegram to his oldest son, "Heartbroken, will write next week." The deposed royal passed away at age 55, destitute in a Paris hotel, a casualty of the Raj. In an act of noblesse oblige, Queen Victoria installed her 17-year-old goddaughter in a grace and favor residence opposite Hampton Court Palace. The shy Sophia was content to dress in the latest Parisian fashions, breed her prized Pomeranians, and participate in the bicycle craze. The pauper princess became a rebel with a cause through a series of events that made her no longer willing to be an exotic bird in a gilded cage. The initial event that awakened Sophia's political conscience occurred when Northwestern University, near Chicago, rescinded her sister Bomba's acceptance to study medicine, a career denied to women in the United Kingdom, as the public believed that lady doctors were an affront to the natural order of things. A despondent Bomba returned to England and shared her bitterness with Sophia. Britain had forbidden the members of the Singh family to return to their ancestral homeland, fearing that the presence of the royals could incite dissent against the Raj. Dissent ran high in the country, as its people were not overjoyed with Queen Victoria's proclamation that India was the jewel in her crown. However, when the English planned a spectacular celebration near Delhi for the coronation of Edward VII, three of the Singh sisters secretly sailed for the subcontinent. The siblings rode across their lost lands on horseback and made their way north to the family's old stronghold of Lahore, where they realized the magnitude of what the British had stolen. The trip brought an understanding of why their father had been mired in a bitterness that eroded his soul. When she returned to England, Sophia was a committed anti-colonialist who wrote, "India, awake and free yourself." Sophia likened Britain's subjugation of its colonies to its oppression of women. The connection was made manifest after Lord George Curzon relinquished his post as Viceroy of India, where he vehemently opposed the country's independence, and became the president of the National League for Opposing Woman Suffrage. Her first step on the crusader path was to sell copies of the suffragette newspaper outside Hampton Court Palace. Her efforts earned her the name the Hampton Court Harridan. If this were not infuriating enough for the crown, Sophia joined the Women's Tax Resistance League, an act that led to two court appearances. She told the authorities, "When the women of England are enfranchised, I shall pay my taxes willingly. If I am not a fit person for the purposes of representation, why should I be a fit person for taxation?" In response, bailiffs entered her home and left with her valuable jewels as payment. Princess Singh became affiliated with the Women's Society for Social and Political Union, the country's leading suffrage organization. The disenfranchised ladies chained themselves to lampposts, smashed windows, and bombarded Parliament with complaints. Their efforts promised to bear fruit until Prime Minister Herbert Asquith sabotaged legislation that would have given women who owned property the right to vote. Infuriated, the spurned ladies turned to more militant measures. In 1910, on Black Friday, 300 suffragettes marched to the seat of the British Parliament, the House of Commons. At the head of the group was the organization's leader, Emmeline Pankhurst. Beside her was a diminutive woman, Sophia Singh. She was the focus of curiosity. She was Queen Victoria's goddaughter, a fixture at society parties, had graced the covers of fashion magazines. On this date, Sophia walked with a group who had been warned that, if they persisted, matters could turn ugly. Outside the Commons, police officers turned on the protesters, knocking them to the ground. Home Secretary Winston Churchill had ordered the officers to refrain from making arrests, as he did not want jails filled with rabble-rousing suffragettes hell-bent on garnering publicity. Rather, the strategy was to tire the demonstrators, forcing them to leave of their own accord. For 5 hours, the scenario played out. At one point, Sophia charged at an officer who was harassing a demonstrator. Infuriated, Sophia demanded his badge number and later lodged a formal complaint. Churchill signed a memo with the order to drop any investigation. Similarly, Churchill refused to look into the deaths of two women who had died of injuries sustained during the protest. The following year, on the day of the King's speech to Parliament, Sophia joined a march on Downing Street. Dressed as a fashionable matron and holding an expensive fur muff, police officers assumed she was a well-heeled bystander who had come to wave at the Prime Minister. The officers were shocked when she pushed her way through the crowds and threw herself at Prime Minister Asquith's car, shouting a feminist slogan. After the collision, she pulled from her muff and unfurled a banner that bore the words, "Give women the vote." As had her father before her, Sophia proved a thorn in the side of the British. King George V, Victoria's grandson, agitated by Sophia's civil disobedience, asked his staff, "Have we no hold on her?" The police hauled many of the protesters to jail, where the women embarked on hunger strikes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.